All right. Thanks. Thanks for having me. The title of my talk is "Our Foundation Models: Castles in the Air," and I'll explain what this, where this comes from. Some of you might have seen this floating around on Twitter, but first, I want to maybe introduce myself a little bit, since this is maybe a kind of a different audience than normally what I speak. So I'm a computer scientist, and my training is in statistical machine learning. And so a lot of what I'm going to say is kind of through that lens, but I hope that some of these ideas and intuitions can be, you know, informative or at least provocative in the way we can think about, you know, embodiment, perhaps. But I'm very eager to discuss this topic with you. So 10 years ago, at the end of my PhD, I was really focused on this problem of semantic parsing. The goal of semantic parsing is to take natural language utterances, such as what is the second most populous city in California, and parse it into some sort of logical form or program that captures the semantics of the sentence in such a way that it can be actually executed on a database to produce the answer. So importantly here, there is a notion of semantics and meaning in the kind of a linguistic sense. And this is obviously useful for many question answering applications. And it can also be extended not just for question answering, but for example, natural language commands of robots in some sort of a more grounded domain. So if pick up the largest red block, this could map to some sort of logical form that can be executed to perform some actions. Now, I will definitely admit that there's a lot of things that happen via execution and how do you represent the context, which has been neatly abstracted away, mostly because I'm a language person. But this is perhaps the closest I've gotten to any sort of actual work on grounding. Sometimes in NLP, we talk about grounding, but it's grounding to some sort of virtual world as opposed to the actual embodiment of a physical agent. But putting that aside, so for a long time, I was interested in understanding the meaning of sentences. And that for me, that meant associating these words in natural language with some sort of external thing. For me, it was a database, but you could equally imagine, images or some sort of more richer sensory modalities. So I thought language models were, pretty boring, right? So what is a language model? It's a model that can predict the next word. And all it does is go along and predict word by word, right? So that's not, that's kind of not very interesting. And recent language models are based on these transformer architectures. Details aren't so important, but they're, I guess they're either simple or complex depending on who you ask. And they're trained on lots and lots of data. You crawl the web, you train on this data, and you're just asking the model predict the next word given the context. So a very naive and simple task. If you think about it a little bit, language modeling is actually pretty powerful because in order to predict the next word well, you actually have to at least capture enough information. I don't want to use the word understand because that's very overloaded, but you have to capture enough of the subtleties and long-range dependence to be able to predict the next word well. And many tasks such as that test for actually semantic understanding can be cast as a language model. Okay, so this was, so language models have been around for a long time. The earliest ideas come from Claude Shannon in the late 40s. But recently they've taken new prominence because of GPT-3. So GPT-3 is this language model that OpenAI released in 2020. By the way, is this, I see all of you on the right. Is it covering the screen or is it okay?
It's okay.
Okay, so I can't see all of my slides, but that's okay.
We can see it.
I can paint it. So GPT-3 is just a language model. It's a very large language model, 175 billion parameters. It's a lot, and trained on 570 gigabytes of text, including Wikipedia, books, and so on. And so this itself was a pretty big engineering feat, but what was really shocking, I think, to a lot of people is the type of things it could do. So here I'm going to show you some examples. And the way it works is that the text here is what is given to the language models. And the part not in green is just fed in as a sequence of tokens into the language model. And you're asking the language model complete that quote unquote sentence, but really complete that sequence. So you feed it something like title, NLP researchers at Stanford discover black holes in language models, and article, colon. And then it generates something I think is pretty, you know, remarkable. It talks about Stanford University News Service published a remarkable discovery. You know, it talks about the discovery was a black hole is a region of time space, blah, blah, blah. And then they have found a similar phenomenon in language. They call it a semantic black hole. I don't think this is a real concept as far as I know, but somehow it has occurs when a word or phrase has no clear definition. It has no clear meaning at all. You toss into a word and sentence, it drags down the other words until a whole thing collapses. So this is rather, I think pretty creative and brilliant. You take two completely separate ideas and it sort of fuses them into a coherent, as coherent as you could hope for given the inputs here, tapestry of some sort. Okay, so it can also do summarization, summarizes for a second grade student. You feed it in this passage and output something that's, I didn't check the details whether it's exactly right, but it looks plausible and I'll get to that point a little bit later. And this is not trained for summarization. And one thing interesting about these models is that you can actually quote unquote talk to it in natural language and it usually does something. This is a conversation I had where you can put in some sort of prompt and then you have a dialogue. I'm giving a talk today. Sounds like a fun, what are you talking about? And then they can ask questions. And I asked, do you know of any other examples of paradigm shifts? And it mentions assembly language is object-oriented programming, which is a pretty good example, and another example and so on. So another thing that is kind of a meta skill is called in-context learning. So normally in machine learning, you have examples of inputs and outputs, and you train a model using gradient descent or backpropagation. But here, what you do is you just concatenate all your examples into the prompt of the language model, and then you ask the model to complete. And somehow it can actually detect the relationships between input and output and just continue spewing out both outputs, but also new inputs as well. So this is something that, when I saw this, I was really blown away because this is kind of an emergent phenomenon that I don't think I or anyone even at OpenAI really kind of expected. The scale here matters. So GPT-3 is 175 billion parameters, which is a lot larger than the previous models. Now the models are even larger, 500+ billion parameters. And the scale here matters. So this in-context learning, this meta ability to learn in the language model, if you try a small model, it looks like it's basically not working. But when you get up to 175, then it actually shows non-trivial performance. And this is one of the also frustrating things about this, because if you need to scale up to actually see any results, then it makes it very hard for, especially for academic researchers to study these things. Okay, so I want to also stress that I talked about language models, GPT-3 in particular, but there's a whole host of multimodal models, including DALL-E and CLIP. And just last week, there was an announcement from Google. This is Palm, which is their newest language model that can produce outputs, but also interestingly generate quote unquote explanations. So it can explain this joke, for example, about Google's hiring a whale for their TPU team. And it's, I don't know how cherry picked this is, but nonetheless, I think this is, if it can do anything like this, it's pretty remarkable. And then OpenAI released this multimodal model where you give it a caption like a teddy bear on a skateboard and can generate a fairly photorealistic rendering of that caption. And also you can do fairly creative things. For example, you know, I can put, a teddy bear who's on the moon on the 80s, computer or something. And so novel scenes that it's never seen before, it can sort of synthesize, just like kind of how GPT-3 was able to synthesize black holes and NLP. So this is all, this has happened very quickly in the last few years. These models, all of these models I've talked about, is this class, are examples of a larger class of foundation models. And foundation models are these models which are trained on a broad data, which means you have to do this at scale and do it in a self-supervised way if you're really going to be truly broad. And then this model can be adapted to a wide range of downstream tasks. And this is kind of the key, paradigm shift in a way, where traditionally we think about each task as kind of very being independent. You train a model for each task, you build a system for each task. And now there's this general substrate, a foundation model that can be used for all these tasks. So it's a kind of general purpose in some way. There are a lot of foundation models that have been released in the last few years. I do want to stress though that foundation models are, we call them foundation models because they're merely a foundation, right? They are not meant to be the ones which are the end, the whole system. That so when you talk about foundation model can't do X or Y, I think of that as maybe not the really right question, because there's always this kind of adaptation layer that happens, on top. You have to tell the model what you want out of it. And if it can do so many broad things, you kind of have to specify a bit more information about what precisely you want. And therefore, I think of this adaptation as actually, you're critical. And I'll get back to this point in a bit. I don't know if we're doing questions in the middle of talk, but if people want to ask anything, I'm happy to take questions. I know we have an hour, but I can interleave the talk and the questions as well.
Maybe just quick clarifying questions, but maybe hold for longer questions for the discussion. Okay.
I had a quick question. That was a relationship between foundation models and transfer learning.
Yeah, good question. So they're definitely very related. Transfer learning is the idea that if you train on one task, you can do better on another task. So the idea of transfer is key to a foundation model. Typically in the past, when people refer to transfer learning, it's been much more limited, where you have one task and you transfer to another task, or involves kind of joint training. You have to have the tasks in mind first, and then you jointly train, and you see that training on everything helps beyond training on individual things. I think that I think interesting about the foundation model is that it's almost that it's not end-to-end. You train this model kind of oblivious to what you might want to do downstream. And then, which means that, it can do a wider set of things. Like if you look at all the things that GPT-3 do, most of them are not even real tasks. Most of them are kind of these one-off weird tasks that the GPT-3 just happens to be capable of, which I think that's a pretty big change in perspective from more of a task-centric notion to something that's more, I guess, foundation model-centric, if that makes sense.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay. So I've been singing the praises of foundation models a bit, but obviously, and this should have been evident from the first example, is that there's no, in some sense, there's nothing, sorry, I should be more precise. this is an output from GPT-3. So in some sense, if you probe GPT-3, you realize there's really, quote unquote, nothing there, right? Sometimes it gives the right answer, but if you ask, where does Percy Liang live? This is not actually where I live, in case you're trying to find me. So it's not grounded in facts, right? And this is, so this is the kind of the central thing that I want to maybe explore in this talk, and you know whether it matters. I'll quickly go over some of these other problems because I think it's important to highlight the problems. These problems might not be as relevant to this talk or this workshop, but you know they've been known to have serious biases and you know generate toxic you know content. They can be used to spread disinformation. They can be subject to data poisoning attacks where because they're trained on the web, anyone can just put up a website and influence these big models that you know Google and Microsoft are training, which is a pretty bad security vulnerability if you think about it. And you can also extract training data from these models so because they are so powerful that they memorize a lot of the training data. And this could leak private information if your training data has private information in it. Okay, so a lot of these problems, so the way we think about it is there are these really interesting properties of these models, which are surprising, but there are also a lot of problems. So one thing that at Stanford we've been did is last year we formed a new Center for Research on Foundation Models to explore foundation models, both on the technical side, but also on the kind of the social impact side. And this is an interdisciplinary team that includes many people. And last year we put out this report that talks about the range of different issues and perspectives ranging from you know model architectures to training to legal issues to environmental impact and so on. So if you're looking for some lightweight reading, you can look up that paper. We also have been developing tools to help train these foundation models, since most of these are not really that accessible. And then we hosted a workshop last year to explore many of these issues, inviting a larger community. Okay, so it is at this workshop that this man by the name of Jitendra Malik, in a panel, and rather maybe heated panel, declare that these models are really castles in the air. They have no foundation, you know, whatsoever, as an argument for saying why these models are somehow maybe fundamentally, you know, deficient. And so I want to explore this. That's why it's the title of my talk, and I think it's fitting to you know a community who's interested in you know embodiment. There's also, you know, he's not the only one. There's been, even within the NLP community, a lot of, you know, skepticism about, okay, I shouldn't say a lot of skepticism. I think there would be some, you know, voices that talk about how the language modeling task, because it uses form as a training data, in principle, can't lead to the learning of meaning. So form are just, you know, the symbols, the words, and meaning is, in the case of semantic parsing, when I talked about, it's kind of the actual grounding and the semantics. And in the case of a more of an embodied agent, it's you know, something that's anchored more to the real world. So the question is, if you're training on these words, what can you actually, are you really, is this kind of a dead end in some sense if you're just training on words? So let's, I want to unpack this because I think in some ways asking just the simple question is a bit, I don't think it, you can answer this simple question by itself. And, I'm just looking at the chat. I don't know if there's any questions there.
I don't think you need to be distracted by it, Percy.
Okay. All right.
Just riffing on the things you're saying.
All right. So let's explore this. So on one hand, we have these language models which are trained on lots of data based on transformers. And then we have, you know, humans and all the ways in which they kind of exist in the world and learn and, you know, behave. And what are the gaps here? You know, human data is clearly multimodal. It's not just language. It has, you know, actions because you're not just looking at what happens in the world. You're feeling and you actually are, you associate the kind of actions you take with the actual, you know, observations. You can actively collect data by, you know, moving around based on what you, a model of the world. You can, you know, take actions to explore and learn new things. And of course, the architectures are wildly different. Okay, so the question I want to ask here is, how much of the agent's capabilities is lost with each difference? Because I think, you know, obviously these AIs and humans are different. So I really don't think it's interesting to say that, oh, they're different, and they'll probably never be the same. It's just different hardware, different everything. So saying that, oh, okay, it can't be intelligent because it isn't, that doesn't have a liver, and it doesn't really is kind of a straw man in some sense. What I like to explore is critically for each of these pieces, you know, how important is it? And it's, instead of asking this binary questions, is it there or not? You know, the question is how much of the way there can you get where there is some vague notion of, you know, human, you know, intelligence. And I want to stress that there's, you know, many paths to quote unquote, you know, intelligence. And even if you define it in terms of what, you know, humans are capable of. And I think what's interesting is what really is necessary, you know, in spite of these differences, as opposed to pointing out the differences, because of course there's differences. Okay, so let's explore. So before I explore this, one thing I just really want to emphasize is that language models are not foundation models. Foundation models is a strict superset of language models. And foundation models, if you look at the definition I gave, is just a model that's trained on broad data that can be adapted to a wide set of downstream tasks, and is purposely defined that way to be much more general than a language model. So in particular, they can be multimodal. They can be trained on actions. They can be used to power some sort of policy to actively collect data. And right now they're dominated by transformers, but in the future, I really hope that we'll be able to go beyond that. So more of this is a kind of a whole class of the idea of being able to soak in a lot of information and automatically glean structure or learn abstractions from it that can power a wide range of downstream tasks. Okay, so this is almost the other extreme where, you know, if you say, does GPT-3 understand? Clearly, the answer is no. And if you ask, is this foundation models, can they ever understand? The answer is kind of trivially yes, because, well, I mean, okay, we can debate that if people want, but it's so broad that it's hard to say no. So what I want to do is delve a little bit deeply and talk about, you know, whether each of these are, you know, how important is it? And just to set expectations, I'm not going to give you, I can't, give you full answers to these. So these are going to just be some musings if I want to set low expectations, and hopefully we can discuss them. So one thing I want to say is, this perspective of how far you can get with something that's limited, I think is, I want to point out this work, which I think is maybe an example of something you can explore if you take on this perspective. So this is work by a number of authors that take GPT-3 and fuse it with a grounded, value function. in robotics. So the idea is that you have a natural language command, or not a command, but a human says something. I spilled my Coke, can you bring me a replacement? And then GPT-3 is queried and it produces possible continuations. I would bring you the Coke can, pick up the Coke can, bring it to you, or done. And then these possibilities are fed into a language condition, a value function of policy that actually looks at the physical world and can assess, whether this is a good thing to do or not. So here, this diagram shows how there's a kind of a language part prior, if you will, that tells you which of these things to do. And then there's also the affordance, which tells you if you were to do that, how successful you would be. And the idea is, there are many things that seem reasonable, like, maybe get a sponge that would be in the prior, but would be rejected by a policy because there's no sponge, right? So this is a very natural way of fusing the language prior and the value function to show that, well, the language does help. So the language does help you towards this grounded understanding task, even though it itself isn't, grounded. And this is part of the picture. Remember the foundation model, there's kind of adaptation that happens, okay? In this case, the adaptation is very heavy, right? There's a whole, value function there that's not in the GPT-3. And then, so the question is, how much of the heavy lifting can the actual foundation model do? Okay, so there's 4 points, right? There's the multimodal data, actions, active collection, and architecture. So I'll go through each 4 of them and muse on each one. So the question here is, how far can you get with language alone? Remember, foundation models aren't restricted to language. So this question you might think is kind of irrelevant. But as an NLP person, I'm kind of curious. In probabilistic terms, you can kind of think of this as there's some connection represented as a joint distribution over language and grounding, which you want to learn, but you only observe language. So, what can you do? So there's this myth sometimes that goes around that says, well, you can't observe it. So, well, clearly you can't infer anything about it. And this is just wrong in full generality. And I want to give you a very simple analogy from a very basic machine learning model, which is Gaussian mixture model. So a Gaussian mixture model is a distribution over points, where each point is associated with a particular cluster. So in this case, well, there are a bunch of clusters, but let's just focus on, there's 3 main clusters here. And so it's a distribution over the point location and also the cluster assignment, which you can think about as a color here. And in unsupervised learning, you're only given the points and you want to infer the cluster assignments. So if you believe the myth and you think, oh, this is clearly impossible, I don't see any cluster assignments, what can I do? I'm just gonna throw up my hands. But we know from statistical learning that this is possible. The unsupervised learning of Gaussian mixture models is possible not only empirically, but actually it's provably and under some assumption, not crazy assumptions. On the other hand, if you ask the question, does it solve the problem? The answer is not quite, but almost. Because when you do clustering, you only get the clusters up to permutations. You don't actually know, you won't know that this is green, blue, red. You'll know that there's 3 clusters here. And so you still need a bit of information, order number of clusters labels to label the clusters, and that solves the problem. Right. So I think this is a good illustration of how unsupervised learning without observing the quantity of interest can actually give you a lot of the way there, but you still need a little bit. So you can think about this as the adaptation, the labels, as adapting it to the actual task. And so, just to be kind of fully explicit about the mapping, you can think about the points as the language and cluster assignments as the grounded in this case. Now, there is a real thing, which is that unsupervised learning is not is much harder than supervised learning. It requires more data and more compute. And this is one reason why I think, and it also requires that you have the right model structure here, which that's important. But you know, given those things, you can get most of the way there. So I think in practice, why this maybe is doesn't work sometimes is that you know, you might not have enough data or a computer or the right model architecture, but this is possible. At least this is an illustrative example where it's possible. Okay, maybe I'll pause in case there's clarifying questions on this slide.
We are kind of getting into the question answer time. So if you want to maybe say a few words to wrap up, we can just go to there.
Okay. All right, I'll try to go through this. So I just want to point out this other work, Merlo, Reserve. Wow, time really flew by. Okay, I need to speed up. Which trains a model on sound, visual input, and also language as an example of foundation model that definitely tries to go beyond language. The question is, what other modalities aren't necessary, and also importantly, what data distributions is, are YouTube videos enough or do you need to be in the real world? So something. Second point is, how much are actions worth? So we've been exploring this question, and intuitively you think that, well, if you don't act in the world, how can you have a policy if you don't even know how, you know, if you think about playing a video game and I don't tell you which one is left and which one's right, you know, it's impossible. But that's kind of like the clustering problem. I don't know which one's which, but you can learn a lot just from without the actions. So this setup is, you have, this is a meta world kind of simulated robotics environment. You train on all of these tasks and you are trying to, you learn a state representation and you ask, how can you solve these new test tasks in using these state representations? And this is an interesting plot where we tried both having the action available and not having the action available. And both are actually pretty similar, and which suggests that at least in this, you know, limited setting, actions weren't really helping you very much. Because here's a thought experiment. If you could really predict video and how everything moved in the world perfectly, then in some ways, maybe you only need the number of degrees of freedom data of actions to complete the picture. So this is kind of like the number of clusters to complete the picture. Because if you know, in order to put the cup on the table, I just need to see the image of the cup being on the table. Now I can kind of ask, okay, if I move my joint this way, is it going in the right direction? And kind of map that on. Active data collection, this is a classic experiment that argues that, you need active data collection because you're just passively getting data. You can't actually learn about the world. And in machine learning theory, it's true that the active data collection helps you. So with active learning as opposed to passive learning, you get better rates of convergence. You learn faster. But in these cases, you still end up in the same place, at least in the simple sense. You end up in the same place. So it's not clear whether active data collection is somehow an efficiency gain, which is significant in practice, or is it a fundamental thing that more like a 0-1, you just simply can't learn some things if you don't have active data collection. And the fourth thing is architectures. Transformer architectures are very dominant. They're very generic, and they've been surprisingly successful across language and also vision, which is kind of unexpected given how natural convolutions are. But because they're generic, one thing that people have been looking into, this paper from Anthropic that shows this emergent phenomenon that certain of the attention heads in the transformer actually learn kind of these skills for doing, you know, induction. Of course, there's still limitations that it's a fixed sequence length and so on. So, but it's, I think this is an interesting place to kind of push if we were to try to improve the inductive bias of models. I'll just skip that slide. Okay, so just in summary, so our foundation model is castles in the air. I would answer no, but it's also maybe not the right question to ask anyway. As I try to convey, foundation models are a general tool. They're trained on broad data that can be adapted to a wide range of tasks. And you can apply a foundation model in a multimodal setting. You can train it on interactions. You can use it to collect data. And you can use more maybe neurally plausible architectures or that have better modularity or sparsity. But you know, the question that I tend to ask is, how far can you get, and what of these properties are actually necessary? Because I do think that we are kind of on a very different path to some sort of an intelligence anyway. And on that path, I think there's going to be things that matter and things that maybe don't matter. This is maybe more from an engineering perspective. And finally, there's crazy emergent phenomena in these models. And I and also the community, I think, have been surprised enough times in the last years that I think, I at least need to force myself to be very open-minded about what these models can do, because who knows what is going to emerge next year. All right, with that, I will thank you for your attention and happy to discuss more.